series. Today, we're delighted to be co-hosting this event with the Stanford University Woods Institute for the Environment, who Lee Rosenbaum represents him here in Washington and helps us organize these events, and we appreciate her engagement greatly, as well as the Institute as a whole. Today's topic, as you know, is reforming the offshore energy leasing system of the United States in the Arctic. In the U.S. section of the Arctic. We hope with the Woods Hole Institute to actually turn this into several seminars on a variety of the issues that arise through the potential developments that are going to occur in that part of the world. As I think many of you know, we at Resources for the Future are very much committed to trying to produce high-level analysis on critical environmental and natural resource issues, which we consider objective. We're not in the partisan business nor in the advocacy business, but we're trying to do serious research and also try to promote, as we are today, serious conversation, public conversation about these kind of issues. Now, in terms of regulatory systems, which this is about, of course, RFF has a long history in dealing with multiple federal and state regulatory systems related to the environment, whether it's clean air or clean water. But in particularly in recent years, we've been very much engaged as well in oil and gas development regulatory systems. And our folks were advisors to the Oil Spill Commission that was looking at the tragic occurrence in the Gulf of Mexico. And also, we have been deeply engaged in examination of federal and state regulations with respect to the development of shale gas and tight oil in the country. Let me just quickly indicate that obviously our focus today is limited to and is on this question of leasing a system in the Arctic. But I think we all recognize that this issue is nested in a much larger set of questions about climate change. And the first being, of course, that in the Arctic region, most scientists tell us we are seeing observable evidence of the consequences of warming that is occurring and underway in terms of ice behavior, in terms of permafrost melting, and there is genuine change in the physical landscape based on this. We're also seeing develops that aren't necessarily related to climate change, but may be enhanced by climate change. We're seeing significant changes in the commercial developments in this part of the world, in terms of fishing and what's going to be fished, in terms of shipping and the level of shipping that's going to likely increase, and in terms of resource development, in particular, the possibility of oil and natural gas. And as we know, the development of oil and natural gas represents the carbon source that is going to be developed. And the question then is how does that take place within the broader context of a number of governments and the global institutions trying to find policies that restrict the ultimate carbon emissions and other greenhouse gases. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that's not going to be our focus on these broader set of issues, but we're not oblivious to that. Our focus is going to be on the leasing system. And I'm very delighted to turn this over to one of our top individuals here at Resources of the Future, Dr. Alan Krupnik, who is the co-director for our Center for Energy and Climate Economics. And Alan has dealt with multiples over the years of these different regulatory systems in the United States and trying to make them work more effectively to accomplish the goals and accomplish it whenever possible in a cost-effective manner. So he's going to moderate today's panel, and I'll turn it over to him.
Thanks very much, Phil. And I'm very happy to welcome you all to RFF and to one of our initial forays into Arctic issues. We really do have an extraordinary panel here. You have their bios on your chairs, but I wanted to point out a few things here. First of all, we'll be leading off with Bill Brown, who's the current Chief of Environmental Officer at the Bureau of Ocean and Energy Management. That's BOEM. So there's BOEM and there's BESI. They're both in the Department of Interior, and they both share responsibilities for development in the Arctic and elsewhere of oil and gas. We have twice former Deputy Secretary at Department of Interior, David Hayes. So David's been working in the Arctic. He's also currently a Stanford law professor, and David's been working in the Arctic for some time and is quite an expert in his own right. And then we have our own Jan Mayers. Jan himself was a assistant secretary at the Department of Energy and held some other senior positions in the federal government over time. And he was sitting on the steering committee for the National Petroleum Council's just released report on Arctic oil and gas exploitation, available technologies, future possible technologies and policy implications. So Jan is going to talk about that. And then finally, we're very lucky and grateful to hear a local perspective on these issues. And this is something that we really miss in Washington. I was talking to our guest here, Willie Goodwin, who's a former mayor of a town on the Bering Sea, Kotzebue it's called. And this town could well be affected both positively and negatively from such development that we're talking about here, and has been very active in institutions addressing ecological and economic issues with development in Alaska and trying to bring some of those benefits of such development home to the people who live there. So we're going to focus, as Phil said, on the regulatory framework for offshore oil and gas in the federal outer continental shelf. This new system is poised to change substantially since the lease sales were held in 2008. This is the one that Shell has been so much in the news about, and even yesterday there was news that the environmental impact assessment was just approved by DOI. So another step on the way towards eventual development up there. And the focal point of today's panel then is this, what's called the targeting leasing model that Boehm and Bessie have come up with, and then also their proposed Arctic drilling standards, to the extent that Bill wants to talk about them, and how these will meet the needs of sustainable development of the Arctic. Now, of course, it's not just the Department of Interior that has responsibilities in the Arctic. There are over 20 federal agencies with responsibilities of various types. There's the state of Alaska. There's the local governments. There are tribal entities. There are multi-level governmental institutions. There's NGOs and an army of academics that are up there. And they're all playing a role. And their work in data collection and policy formulation needs to be coordinated, and implementation as well needs to be coordinated, and David's going to talk a bit about that. And then the Department of Energy's secretary asked the National Petroleum Council to do this report, and Jan is going to be talking about that, and finally we'll have the local perspective from Willie. So I wanted to thank in particular my research assistant, Katrina McLaughlin, who's here. She came to RFF as a real expert in Arctic, all things Arctic, and has helped us get up to speed on these issues and helped design this event, as well as Lee Rosenboehm from Woods. Housekeeping, this event is being webcast. So people out there who are listening and watching this event, feel free to tweet in your questions. We will have a question and answer section near the end. Our Twitter account is #AskRFF, #AskRFF. Yeah, I'm betraying my age. Okay, fine. I blog a lot. I don't tweet, but I blog a lot. Yeah, that's funny. And then the bathrooms, the men's room is back there around out through this door if you want to disrupt the entire proceedings. And then the women's room is out back in there and they're like a block away. I'm very sorry about that. Really sorry about that. Okay, so let's get started. We're going to have Bill come up first, give a talk. We'll go through the four talks. And then everybody will come up here in the panel and we'll have a question and answer period. So thank you very much. So Bill, if you want to be up here, that's fine. I'm moving.
Well, thank you, Alan and Phil for the introductions, and I'd note I feel very much at home in this building. I was on the Environmental Law Institute's board for a long time years ago, and they were housed here at the time. I guess they still are, and I've known a lot of the Bob Fry and a lot of the board members of RFF for a long time. It's very important, I think, the leading natural resource economics think tank in the United States, maybe in the world. I mean, it's a leader in these things, and we're lucky to have the institution around. I'm just going to touch base on the Department of Interior sort of basic policy that engages the department in offshore energy, talk a little bit about the five-year program, which is sort of the mainstay of how it does business. Talk a little bit about Arctic leasing and the targeted approach to leasing. And I can comment on the proposed regulations of Boehm and Bessie that relate to safety in the Arctic. And then finish with a small comment on climate issues. At the foundation of Interior's involvement, there's a statute. It's the Outer Continental Shelf Lands Act, or OCSLA, which was passed in the 50s and then redone in 1978. It's been that ever since. And it calls on the Secretary of Interior to pursue expeditious and orderly development of gas and oil on the Outer Continental Shelf, subject to environmental safeguards. So when you look at the department and what it's doing in this arena, it's important to note that there is an energy development policy and environmental protection policy. I'd note not everybody knows it, but the Interior Department is also regulating other forms of energy on the Outer Continental Shelf, including wind. So when you look at the offshore wind projects, that's us as well. So if we have these five-year programs, they're directed by Section 18 of OCSLA. The current program is 2012 to 2017, and what that program, what the Secretary is asked to do is look at the Outer Continental Shelf around the United States to consider a number of areas that might be developed. To look at energy and environmental matters, and a quite detailed public process. I'll comment on that in a moment. And then come up with a series of proposed lease sales. And leasing is the way in which companies can get involved in development on the OCS through bids, and then the issuance of leases and then the payment of rents and royalties in addition to the awards that they make, the bid price. Targeted leasing has actually been around for quite a while in Alaska. It's not new with the current program. There were three areas, including a 25-mile corridor along the coast of the Chukchi and subsistence whaling areas offshore Kaktovik and Barrow that were in the Bush administration five-year program. And then there were four areas, now there's a fifth, that were excluded from lease sales in the current five-year program in the Arctic. There was added to what I just said, an area of subsistence use northwest of Barrow. And then most recently, as I think a number of people here have probably noted, that President Obama on January 27th withdrew all those areas indefinitely, unless another president comes in and changes it, withdrew them from the potential for leasing and added another area, which is known as Hannah Shoal, and it's an area that walruses feed on heavily. So the five-year program process is very public. The Interior Department has published a draft proposed plan for 2017 to 2022. It was published in January. It has 14 lease sales that are contemplated, and one of them is in the Chukchisi and one is in the Beaufort. All of these areas that the president has withdrawn are not subject to potential leasing. And we're in the midst of preparing a programmatic environmental impact statement that's associated with what will be probably the final decision on this forthcoming five-year plan, which the department intends to make by the end of 2016. The rationale for targeted leasing is pretty straightforward. It's we have a mandate to protect the environment, and the areas that have been excluded are important to walrus, they're important to ducks, they're important to a number of migratory animals, and then we also have a duty to consider the interest of subsistence users, and we take that very seriously. And so there are areas, I mean, there are voices in among the Alaska Natives that vary in terms of whether they're against or for development, but I would say they're unified in their shared interest to protect the resources so they're around for use. So that's moving forward. We did, the department did yesterday affirm leases in the Chukchisi. There are 460 active leases, and they had been suspended because of litigation, but the department has affirmed them. And as you would probably note from the press, Shell, Royal Dutch Shell, is taking steps to explore in the Chukchisi this summer with two drilling rigs. But that is still subject to additional approvals from the Interior Department. On the Arctic Standard Rule, quickly, it codifies requirements that were in place in 2012, and then it adds experience that was learned from some problems at the end of that related to planning. And one of the new things is an integrated operating plan that makes sure there's time to really take a hard look at by the agencies involved and interaction with the company about what's actually being planned. But the proposed regulations, which were published on February 24th, and they're open to comment through April 27th, they recognize the Arctic as a frontier area, and it's difficult. It is difficult to work up there offshore. The area is also short on infrastructure. If you were to single out, I think, in addition to the harsh climate, a big difference is there's a lot less infrastructure to deal with any issues than there is, say, in the Gulf of Mexico. So to summarize some of the key points, that proposed regulation requires generally that any operator be ready for the harsh Arctic requirements. It would require the submission of an integrated operating plan 90 days before an exploration plan is submitted. It would require some very specific technical things, which are that there be a capping stack that could be put on a well that has lost control within 24 hours, that there's a containment dome with a flow system, they call them sombreros, which can be put in place within 7 days after any loss of control, that blowout preventers be tested at least every 7 days, it used to be 14, that there be a separate relief well that can come in and drill, plug, and sort of leave the area a maximum of 45 days. But the basic thing is to make sure it's there in time to get the job done before ice forms. And then the ability to track and respond to ice conditions. Very important thing to be able to manage contractors. That was one of the issues that came up. How effective is the contractor management plan? And then that there be a really effective, worked out, tested oil spill response plan. So if anything happens, people know just what to do. I will note, though, one thing everybody should think about in terms of activity up there, that vessel traffic in general is a big issue. And even when the Shell company was up in Alaska in 2012, it was 90% of the vessel traffic was not related to energy. And the last year that I have reports from, it was 98% was non-energy and 2% energy. So there is a concern about managing vessel traffic unrelated to this. And then on climate, and that'll be my closing remark. Just to note, it is the entire U.S. government, I think, is on board with recognizing that climate change is a global priority. That its effects are magnified in the Arctic, as many have noted, with melting ice, melting permafrost, temperature double. It's not just wildlife impacts from climate, it's impacts on the people that the Alaskan natives. But I would also note for you that the transition to reduced atmospheric carbon emissions is not an overnight affair. And to find the right path forward, we need people like the economists that prowl the corridors of RFF and think about things like carbon taxes. And a carbon tax where you might actually impose that tax, but reduce other taxes. And, you know, so I'll just say for now, I do think it's hard to escape the fact that our economy depends on a supply of fossil fuels, and that domestic production is a source of security in a politically volatile world. So thank you.
Thanks, Bill. So next up is David Hayes. And David, you could come up here too, and we'll dim the lights for your presentation.
Hopefully you're not able to see me as well, too. That's the additional benefit. Thanks for having me here. It's always a pleasure to be here at RFF. I second and endorse everything Bill Brown said about RFF under Phil Sharp's terrific leadership. And Alan, thank you for putting this program together. And on behalf of the Woods Institute for the Environment, which has a collaboration with RFF, Stanford is really pleased to be working with RFF on this matter. The Arctic generally and in broader arena as well. And I'll mention Commander Dave Slayton is here. Please put up your hand from the Hoover Institute. Hoover at Stanford also has an Arctic security initiative that is relevant to what we're talking about here today. So I am going to move quickly through a presentation. Let's see if I can. So we all know where the Arctic is. We're going to be talking about the Chukchi and Beaufort seas primarily, where an offshore drilling associated with those resources in the Chukchi and the Beaufort. And I'm going to talk quickly about three items. First is the unique challenges associated with offshore drilling in the Arctic. Second, the institutional decision making for Alaska offshore drilling. And finally, a suggestion that decision-making dynamics and a discussion about decision-making dynamics and challenges, and a suggestion that has been embraced by the Obama administration but is hard to do, which is something we call integrated Arctic management. So in terms of the unique challenges associated with offshore drilling in the Arctic, climate change is happening big time. I'll show a slide or two in a minute. And there is a tendency to think, and we all hear about the receding ice in Alaska, off the offshore of Alaska. And it is receding, and we are in the summertime, and we are having more open water, clear open water, typically for perhaps 3 months in the summer. The flip side of that is that the coast, the north coast of Alaska, remains icebound for most of the year. And this is something that's frankly a little hard to digest. But we are looking at potentially drilling and potentially producing in a region that is mostly icebound most of the year. Now that contrasts, for example, with Norway. The Barents Sea is ice-free year-round because of the influence of the Gulf Stream. Alaska still has a very significant ice issue, which means that we have a short exploration season, And one of the standards that the Interior Department is focusing on is how to ensure that the exploration occurs in a time frame that is consistent with open water, so that if there is a spill, there is time to address it before the ice comes in, because there is no technology known to be able to clean up a spill effectively in icy waters. You also have intrusion issues. When Shell had their program in the summer of 2012, they had to get off the Chukchi well because a huge iceberg was heading right for it, and they had to move off, lose a week or two, and then move back. So you still have ice in the water. And then you have an ice scour issue. The Shell approach has a blow-up preventer actually below the level of the seabed because of ice scour. The waters are shallow. That's good in terms of not a deep sea threat in terms of the high pressures and difficulty of access. But you can't have ice scour from the ice coming in and going out and actually scouring the bottom. So you have another additional challenge there. Fragile marine and coastal resources, obviously, with a particular emphasis, and I'm sure Willie will talk about this, on the cultural resources and the subsistence culture, the need to access and maintain the viability of the whales, the seals. The marine mammals are important not just for themselves, but also because of their relationship with the people of the Arctic. And finally, and very importantly, a challenge of the lack of supporting infrastructure, which I'll talk about more in a minute. Just the climate change point very quickly, you know about this. The IPCC predicted a very rapid warming, and that's what we're seeing. In terms of predictions for sea ice, the headline is what we all sort of process, nearly ice-free Arctic Ocean in September, likely before mid-century. Well, that's interesting, but what about the rest of the year? Well, the seasonal cycle will have still maximum extent in March. Look on the upper left-hand corner there. That's where you, if you look upside down, you can see Alaska and the Bering Strait, all full of ice typically in March. And so you have an open season for drilling, but in terms of year-round activity, you do not have access. The marine ecosystem, I'm not going to talk about. You know the sensitivities, walruses, polar bears that are dependent to some extent in their life cycle on access to ice are in trouble. Polar bears now on the endangered species list, walruses potentially behind them. But you also have sensitive fishing issues, the important cultural access to whaling, etc. And then the lack of supporting infrastructure. Bill referenced this, but I was the first administration official down the morning after the Deepwater Horizon blowout, and spent the next 77 days, in fact, the next 117 days before the relief well killed the Macondo well completely, watching that oil spill. And the key to that, to addressing that, is good infrastructure. You need ample on-site well control capability and containment capability, and after the Deepwater Horizon spill, we required in the Gulf that the industry get together, and they formed $2 billion consortiums, the Marine Well Containment Corporation and the Helix Containment System, each with on-hand capability to deliver a capping stack, to deliver a containment vessel that could take all the oil and also deal with the other aspects, skimming, et cetera. There is no comparable capability in Alaska. In fact, you have no deep water harbors in the U.S. Arctic. The closest deep water harbor is Dutch Harbor. The closest deep water rescue opportunity comes from the Coast Guard down in Kodiak Island, 1,000 miles away. So you have, and then you need ice-capable vessels because there are icebergs in the area. And the International Maritime Organization has confirmed this. You need ice-capable vessels. If there's a problem up there, there is no rescue opportunity. There's no safe port to go to. It's a problem not just for oil and gas, certainly, but for shipping generally. And so obviously there are limited vessels of opportunities for rescue, for cleanup assistance. And if you go to Wainwright or Point Hope
or Barrow, all of which I've been to, or Kotzebue, you will find very few boats because of the shallow water. This is how supplies are delivered to Barrow, by lightering on barges. It's extremely shallow. That's good for drilling. That's bad for infrastructure support. The other interesting thing, and the last point in my previous slide, is there's no currently viable mechanism to deliver oil into markets. This is another long-term challenge for development that really needs to be understood. The Chukchi target lease areas, that's 70 miles off the coast of Wainwright. I flew out there two summers ago. It's a long way. If there's a major production found, there's going to need to be likely an undersea pipeline that would go perhaps to Wainwright, perhaps down to Point Lay, and then further south, although Kevalina is not a deep water port. If it goes onshore, then you're going to have to go about 300 miles through pristine wilderness area, wilderness quality area, I should say, of the National Petroleum Reserve. That would be an amazing and challenging proceeding. And you know the story of the drilling season in 2012. It was not a pretty story. It illustrated a lot of these challenges, including the harsh conditions, which I didn't mention, just the harshness of the cold, of the fact that you don't have much on-scene or onshore infrastructure available, the ice encroachment, the difficulty of operating ships effectively in the Arctic. Just lots of challenges. And of course, the Kullock, losing control of the Kullock and having it lost on the shores of Alaska New Year's Day following that season. I want to move on to institutional decision making and then close with integrated Arctic management. As Bill mentioned, there are a gaggle of federal agencies involved in the Arctic. Shell was extremely concerned about, in a run-up to 2012, about not having one place to go to have integrated a federal review of their drilling plans. It was a legitimate concern. The president did an executive order that addressed this, Executive Order 1380, that appointed the Deputy Secretary of the Interior, that was me at the time, and gave me the responsibility to coordinate all the federal entities involved. And for the first time ever, we had EPA, we had NOAA, we had the Coast Guard, and all interested agencies dealing with offshore drilling, going over the exploration plan, going over the logistics and all of that. That's the kind of thing the federal government should do. And because of that structure, I think that we now have a permitting system in Alaska that is sound. What that made us do, though, so we were charged with coordinating permitting for all energy projects in Alaska. And here's what we found as we looked at the ConocoPhillips project in the NPRA, as we looked at ExxonMobil's project in Point Thompson. What we found was, in the Arctic in particular, it is not smart to just go project by project, permit by permit. We have a fragile ecosystem with a lot at risk. We have stakeholders in the Native Alaskans, the state of Alaska, municipalities, et cetera. We have environmental sensitivities that we don't fully understand. It does not make sense to have a limited sort of pinpoint permit decision without an understanding of the context. We called for an integrated Arctic management approach in a report to the president, and the president has picked that up, but what that means is, I'm going to say it in 20 seconds because my time is up. What it means is you don't just, all of the decision makers involved, and this is federal across the agencies, this is often the state, certainly for input, and certainly consultation with Native Alaskans, all of those folks should be involved in looking ahead and planning what they want for the future of their Arctic, and understanding also the sensitivities, the environmental sensitivities. Where is the best spot for a deep water port if we're going to have a deep water port? Where is the best spot to potentially have future oil production, assuming we're going to have future oil production? That is a with meaningful partnerships with all the interested parties, science-based decisions that will provide the information up front to make permitting decisions. Final slide. There are some early interagency collaborations that show a sensitivity to this approach. The National Arctic Strategy explicitly endorsed this approach. The Arctic Implementation Plan, January of 2014, endorsed this approach. The President's executive order that established the Arctic Executive Steering Committee endorsed this approach. They're looking for now a working group on how this will happen. The big question I have is, can the U.S. effectively pull this off? Thank you.
Thank you, David. I know you could go on all day with this, and it was fascinating, so I appreciate you cutting it. So next will be Jan Mayers.
I'm going to talk about the National Petroleum Council study. The National Petroleum Council was created in 1947 to advise the then Secretary of Interior, now the Secretary of Energy, in response to questions that the Secretary provides to the Council. I actually had the privilege to participate because Phil Sharp is a member of the Council. About two-thirds of the members are from industry and a third are not from the industry. Now, the Council was asked by Secretary Moniz to provide him recommendations regarding research and development that would deal with enhancing the prudent development of oil and gas resources in the Arctic, and also related to policy issues since the U.S. will be the chairman of the Arctic Council beginning this month. Finally, the context you get a sense of from listening. There is a lot of interest in oil and gas development in the Arctic. Russia is drilling wells in the Arctic. China is an observer to the Arctic Council and is actually involved with financing resource management in the Arctic. The U.S. oil potential offshore in our Arctic seems to be about 44 billion barrels of oil equivalents in less than 100 meters of water. That's actually pretty shallow by oil and gas development offshore. Now, the team that studied this was a 267 individuals. 58% were not, I repeat, not from the oil and gas industry. They were from academia, many governments, state, local, federal, people in technology areas, people in think tanks, wide variety of people that were involved. What were the key findings? Now, if you don't have, there is a set of these slides that's outside that if for the people in the room that don't have it, you could then get it. But I'm just going to let you read it because it's the quickest way to go through these slides, and I'm going to talk about a few of them sequentially. All right, on the Arctic. There's been a lot of research, and we can recommend further research dealing with various aspects of operations in the Arctic. The conditions vary significantly across the Arctic. The most important considerations for oil and gas exploration development are ice type, water depth, and open water season, and those are reflected in the three pictures across the top here, or the bottom here. First year ice, and then multi-year with ridges, and then finally open water and yet with an iceberg that came across. Now, there's actually been a long history of offshore Arctic oil and gas development, almost 50 years worth. And most significantly in three areas, that three types of areas. The lower horizontal bar deals with exploration offshore, relatively near shore. The second middle horizontal bar deals with expiration in less than 100 meters water. And then the third, the highest horizontal bar, deals with production, not expiration, but production in 100 meters of water. And in effect, what's happened is the world has been developing and producing oil in 100 meters of water for more than 20 years. So the proposition is that the technology is advanced and it's possible. Now, most of our Arctic is developable because it's in less than 100 meters of water. In this chart, focus on the three highest rows, and they have pictures because those are examples of where development is taking place. And then if you look in the middle column, the red markings, those are, in effect, U.S. Chukchi, Beaufort seas. In other words, that's the area where there has been experience and development of oil and gas. And that's the area where the potential for the U.S. appears to be. This is one of the most important things of this study. There's a whole chapter in the study, and it's right here. It's now posted on the website. It was presented to the Secretary last Friday. It's probably going to be 500 pages when it's ultimately printed. And there's a chapter in here on spill prevention and control. One of the things, and David talked about it, there have been a lot of changes since Macondo. There have been changes in the terms of the regulation. There was much learning that took place. Because this bow tie, the focus first on the left-hand side as you look at it. That's the prevention side. And there are multiple barriers for prevention, and that's what everybody in any industry wants to do, is prevent accidents. And today, the methodology to do that is even greater than it was 5 years ago. So as I say, there's new regulatory requirements. I won't go through them. I can if you really want. And then in addition, those are barriers. There are barriers in the well operation itself. And then finally, there's a blowout preventer, which is subsea because it's up in the Arctic, as David said. Now, if by chance none of those work and there is a spill, then there are things on the prevention side that can be done. The first one that would be the most significant in terms of reducing any possibility is what's called a subsea shutoff device. I'll show a picture of that in a minute. Second one would be a capping stack, which could be put on top of the blowout preventer and stop the flow. Then you can also, there are also ways, and there have been a lot of development in the Arctic dealing with how you can address an oil spill. And there's a lot of disadvantages of an oil spill in the Arctic, but there are actually some advantages in terms of trying to address it. And then finally, there's the potential for having a relief well to drill a well to plug and abandon the well. So there's an awful lot in the study about that subject. Now let me turn quickly to the recommendations, and they're broadly in three categories. The first category is environmental stewardship. In the first bullet, we collectively recommended that industry and regulators work together to look at existing data and decide what more is needed by demonstration, public demonstration or otherwise, to validate and accept new technologies that are available to reduce the likelihood of a spill or the consequences. And two in particular are the subsea isolation device, which I described, which the picture is on the left, and that is in effect like a second totally independent blowout preventer that would be beneath the real blowout preventer. It would be separately operated, separately powered, so that it would be in effect an auxiliary. And then the other is a capping stack, which is then, if it was needed, it's put on top of the blowout preventer and then closes down. The significance of both of these is to reduce substantially the potential for there to be a spill in the first instance, but then also reduce the amount of spill, because it takes in the case of the subsea isolation device, that can happen instantaneously when the event potentially occurs. Capping stack takes a while to put on, and it'd be that period when the spill occurs, and that's a lot shorter time in terms of potential for spill than waiting out a same season relief well. The second and third bullets are recommendations in the area of oil spill response. One is to urge the government to participate with industry on a series of programs they have that are doing research in that area. And they also recommend the availability use of making all of the oil spill response technologies that have been developed and proven used available in the course of, if it's necessary. Now, there has been a great deal of research on Arctic species, but as with almost anything that we do in life, there's more that could be learned that would be useful and enhance the ability of us collectively to protect the species. And we recommend several different areas of research in that regard. We also recommend that there be collaboration and coordination of ecological and human environment research so that it would ensure that the right data is collected and it would be shared. And finally, we recommend that there be an updated socioeconomic impact assessment protocol to enable better data, better sharing of data, particularly baseline data across the interested parties. Now, turning to the second broad theme of recommendations, this is on economic viability. The first bullet relates to validating techniques to extend the drilling season in the course so that you could go farther in the season. Today, the season is, for want of a better term, say 2 months. I think there are the view that with additional technologies, the risks of spills or otherwise can be sufficiently reduced that the drilling could take place longer in a given season. The consequences of that would be it allows a prospect to be identified and developed in a shorter period of time, which means it's less costly. And the recommendation is that the ideas that would allow that to happen be validated and demonstrated so that obviously the regulators have to be satisfied, but so would others, that this technology can be deployed and would be worthwhile. The second actually relates to the lease of the term and when a party can move from, in effect, a fixed term to an essentially an unlimited term when they're developing the oil. The experience in the United States appears to be much tighter and more limited than in other countries, which means other countries are more attractive as a place to invest in this regard. And so we basically have asked that there be an evaluation of that particular issue. And then government leadership and policy coordination. David covered this quite effectively and well. We're not going to add, ours doesn't add anything. I'll let you read this, and then we'll be able to go on and have our real speaker speak to us. All right, with that, I'm finished.
Thanks, Jan, for giving us a good indication of what's in that report. And now Willie Goodwin is going to come up.
Take it off. Okay. There you go, and she'll time you.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to come before you, and I thank RFF, is that it? And I especially want to thank Beth Gertula. She's the one who gave me the frantic phone call Monday and said, can you come down? And I said yes, because it normally drives me nuts when people try to figure out what's best for us without us being involved, us meaning the native people of northern Alaska. And if I can be of any kind of help to help you decide what's best for us, then I want to be a part of it. So I came down. What we're mostly afraid of up north is, and Kotzebue is 30 miles above the Arctic Circle. And our people have been around for a while. And I'm an Inupiaq. That's the name of our people. And in English, it means the real people. That's what it basically means, the real people. We're deathly afraid of an oil spill. Let me use that in this context. you're figuring out what's best for my refrigerator. And if you take a glass of crude oil or any kind of oil and just splash it around in there and do your best to clean it up, you'll still have in your mind it smells, whether you put other food in there or clean it up as best as you can. So my comments are going to be based on personal knowledge or traditional knowledge. This, the stuff I'm going to talk about, is not something that I've read about and learned about. It's something that I've experienced, especially if I talk about resources in our land, in our ocean at home. The best practices, I think, that should be used by industry and policymakers is to have the native people, the people that use the area, involved in the decision making and or policy decisions that to move forward with whatever activities are going to happen in our refrigerator. It's important to my people because we have lived off the resources and in Kotzebue's case for 7,000 years. But there's some archaeological evidence that the Inupiaq people have been around for over 18,000 years. So we've been there forever. And I'm sure that after all the oil and gas has been sucked out, we'll still be there. We'll still be there. Remember that. One of the failures of what I see right now is the consultation. A lot of times we read in the paper that the lease sales are happening without any consultation with whether it's the organization, the government, or the people itself. And the last one, there's been an attempt to consult us, but not good enough in my mind. I'll give you an example. This last designation for ice seal habitat, the tribe got a letter that they're going to designate the whole Arctic Ocean as for ice seals. It didn't make any sense to me because if you're going to protect something, I think the protection should be where these animals or marine mammals are born. And for the ring seal, I know that the pups are born on surefast ice, not on the ice that's moving around out there. I've witnessed myself bearded seals being born on the moving ice, but that's after they've migrated north. And what I'm talking about here, all of the sea mammals that we utilize migrate north except for the pregnant female seals, the ring seals. All the others have their young somewhere else. So for us to, for somebody to say you got to protect the whole ocean for the seal pup doesn't make any sense to me. You know, certainly they use the different areas for other activities for themselves, for the seals. As an example, our tribe, the Kotzebue tribe, have tagged more seals than the government itself. Through grants and such, we've had an opportunity to tag seals out of Kotzebue Sound. And some of the ring seals and spotted seals, right after they tagged, they head straight over to Russia on that side. Some go up north to the ice pack. Some go far south as Bristol Bay. So they're everywhere. Sure, certainly they're everywhere, but it's for different reasons. You know, now I don't know if I tell the people in Bristol Bay, you know, the males that we've tagged have all gone down to Bristol Bay to breed. You know, I don't know if they believe that, but, and then some, I know, industry, when there was some seismic activity happening early on when we were first tagging the seals, that some seals would start heading north and then all of a sudden, boom, head back or turn eastward or westward. And then I put that information on to the timing of when the seismic activity was happening, and sure enough, it happened at the same time. And I'm not saying for sure that these seals, because of the booms that go off with the seismic activity, make them turn, but certainly that had an effect to make it turn away. So I think what needs to happen is better understanding of the environment itself. You know, I grew up holistically. That means being aware of everything around me, whether it's the seasons, the animals, the weather. I'm always aware of that when I'm hunting, when I'm out there fishing or something. I'm watching, and it's automatic. I don't even think about it when I do this, because I can recognize danger or something in front of me just by looking at it. And that's how I grew up hunting and fishing. So we know what's out there. We know what time of the year different animals are, either on the land or where they go eat or where they grow up or when they're migrating. And that's what kept our people alive. And it's the same way with the sea mammals. You know, they go north to have their young. The birds go north to have their young. In fact, when we were having the hearings on the Migratory Bird Act, I remember an elder from Kotzebue coming before these people that were holding their hearings, I think it's DOI, and he says, what's all the excitement about? Those are our ducks. They're born and raised up here in the north. So it's the same way with the sea mammals. It's, you know, they're born and raised up in the north. They're especially born in the north. I know that through the scientific portion of studying seals, that the female seal will always come back to where it was born within 10 feet of the area to have its young. And we did that through genetic studies on the molting of the hairs that they've done. So, and also, I also know that the beluga always come back to where it was born to have its young. So these are things that need to be kept in mind when oil exploration or development is happening. And throughout the years, we've watched when something happens, the government or somebody comes up with a reactionary plan. And if you don't have a plan, what are you going to do? It's just like what one of the speakers was speaking about earlier. The closest Coast Guard for any kind of response that we have is in Kodiak. That's a long ways. And what the government, the state of Alaska, provided for response for out of Kotzebue, the van full of booms and such, or they think a response to some kind of an oil spill, it's there, but who knows how to use it? Who knows how to set these booms out? We know which areas need to be protected, because these are areas that the birds come and lay their eggs in the springtime, or where the fish in the estuaries and lagoons where the fish spawn. We know these areas. And for scientists to be flying around and trying to figure out where these things are, it doesn't make any sense to me. Just ask us. Just ask us. We know. We know a lot of this stuff. We grew up around them. Or I did anyway. I know a lot of our native people did. So the consultation is a very important issue to us. And there have been, it's getting better, let me put it that way. It is getting better, but there's a lot of improvements that need to be made. So we don't react to some kind of a decision already made beyond our control, beyond the people's control in Northwest Alaska. A lot of decisions are being made beyond our control. For instance, here in D.C., without any consultation or asking us what's the best practice for something, come up there and ask us. Bring your hearings up there. We'll tell you. We'll tell you what might happen if there's an oil spill or if there's a lot of traffic going up there. And speaking of traffic, we've formed the Arctic Waterways Safety Committee, and all of you know that throughout both east and west coast, there's harbor safety committees. In absent harbors in Alaska, northern Alaska, we changed it to the Arctic Waterways Safety Committee, and it involves five marine mammal commissions, the hunters from the coast of Alaska, five seats for the government agencies, or let me put it this way, for the two boroughs and the city of Nome, the tribal governments, and the Marine Pilots Association, and then five seats from industry. So it's a 15-member committee that we formed to figure out the best practices for marine safety all the way north. You know, the Coast Guard just finished up a PARS, or a highway to the north, that just only goes 20 miles above the Bering Straits, where it's the narrowest. And we need to see that extended further north so that all of the shippers have a highway to follow to go north. What happened with the formation of this committee was the hunters from St. Lawrence Island in 2012 started to see all this fishing traffic while they're hunting. So they made the rest of us aware that we certainly need to do something for marine safety for everybody, not including the hunters and or any ship traffic. So we formed a waterway safety committee to see what kind of input that we can have to provide the safety for everybody. We certainly don't want to be worrying about a big ship coming while we're hunting, you know. And I'm sure the big ships don't want to worry about a little boat that's hunting while it's going north. Yeah. So for the safety of all of our marine users, we formed this committee to give influence to all the shippers. In fact, with the PARS situation, the insurance companies are going to require, they told us they're going to require, if the shippers want or marine traffickers want insurance, they need to follow what's established. And I'm very happy for that, because at least we can know that they'll have a track going north that they have to follow, like any of your highways here. So, I guess the best advice I can give to agencies that are doing this is, you know, we need to have involvement with the different commissions, because all of our commissions have provided management plans, the Beluga Committee, the ICL Committee, Walrus Commission, Polar Bear Commission, and Eskimo, the Arctic Quail Commission. So we have management plans within, like the Blue Committee from Bristol Bay to the Canadian border. We have we involve the communities to work with natural marine fisheries on making sure that the stability of belugas are there. We have harvest levels, and we know that we're not over hunting the beluga whale, so the populations are stable. But we do research, and the biggest thing that we're really concerned about is the funding to do research for these various sea mammals is dwindling every year. We haven't done a survey of belugas to get the estimates of populations in 10 years because of the lack of money. So we need that very badly. And there's, you know, there have been some attempts to count the seals and to make a decision just based on the ice is wrong. You need to know what's out there. Because if you're going to make a decision, whether it's a habitat or regulations of harvest, know what's out there first. You know, it don't make any sense to make a decision without knowing what you're faced with. So, let me close with some comments on Red Dog. Because I'm from Northwest Alaska, and that's the largest zinc mine, lead zinc mine in North America, and because we, the native people, own the land around that mine due to the Last Native Claim Settlement Act, we had some very in-depth meetings with our people. We have a subsistence committee for the road itself from the mine to the port, which is a 52-mile road, that if caribou are crossing, all of the truck traffic stops so the caribou can migrate through. The other thing is we don't allow shipping of any of that ore until July 10, because July 10 is right around the area when we quit hunting sea mammals. So other entities throughout the state are starting to use that as a model. I know there's some other things like the conflict avoidance agreements with some oil companies to make sure that the subsistence whale hunters, bowhead whale hunters, are given the best opportunity to harvest the whales, and that seems to work up north. I don't have the in-depth knowledge of that, but that's happening up north, and it's working. All of these things, like the Red Dog agreement that we have with Techcominco, we put in place so we don't react to something that happens. It's a proactive approach instead of a reactive approach. And with oil and gas, we certainly don't want to see a reactive approach. If there's any way that we can influence or help you with making the proactive approach to oil and gas development in the Arctic, we're there. Just ask us. Thank you.
Wonderful remarks. Thank you, Willie. Okay, so could the panelists come up to the panel here, to the table? And so we have microphones up here. Do we have some people that would like to ask questions? Otherwise, I'll jump in, but I see we do. So go right ahead.
Hello. My name is Linda Preby, and I'm an attorney in private practice here in Washington, D.C. I'm the chair of federal relations and compliance, including the Arctic, and I mostly focus on shipping. One of my questions to you, Mr. Goodwin, relates to the operation in general of the offshore drilling rigs. Obviously, a huge spill is a significant concern, obviously, for you and for all of us around the world. But I've been told by small commercial fisher people that the rigs leak all the time. There's always oil coming off the rig, and it's pooling around that area, and it's causing them to have to find other fishing areas because they view that as contaminating the fish stocks there, which they are trying to fish from. Do you see that as well?
I'm not sure about the fishing industry because it's not that far north. It's all in Cook Inlet, and I'm sure those are where the comments came from. And I'm not really prepared to answer that, but I'm sure if they've said that, then it's happening. And of course, that would be a concern for our hunters if there's some oil chain around there, because you know these seals come up and for air. Or whales.
Yes, please.
Nick Snow with Oil and Gas Journal. Thank you for having this as a follow-up to the NPC's report. My question is, you've identified some significant shortcomings, facilities that don't exist in Alaska at this point, in particular involving spill response. And my question is, who's going to pay for them? Is there going to be enough production up there to justify the expense?
Just jump in.
Well, let me at least speak to how the, is this on? Can you all hear me?
Yeah.
All right. First of all, there's a lot of work on the prevention side so that we try to reduce by almost everything you one can possibly do to prevent any spill at all, as well as reduce it substantially. The operator is obliged in getting their permit to explain in great detail, and Bill can treat to this, what they would do in the event of a spill. I mean, what response vessels they're going to have, and related things. And a lot of the decision in a given case is going to be dependent upon what, in fact, is the weather, ice, and related conditions, because each of those facts affect the spreading of the spill, how quickly it disperses, and related. There's been a large amount of research done over quite a few years, but certainly over the last five, by oil and gas companies around the world on these various issues. A lot done in Norway and in Canada, where there's actually been tests of recovery of spills that have been done. There's also been evaluations, much of which is in the report, about the impact of dispersed oil on species. So there's a lot we know. Do we know everything we'd like to know? No. But are there things that at least this group of people thought would be useful further advances in our knowledge that we could do? The answer is absolutely yes.
If I can add to that, the specific question about liability, the operator has a liability, certainly, for the cleanup. We saw that with the Gulf oil spill as well. The important point, though, your point about the infrastructure challenges here, this is why the Interior Department has a special proposed rule out for special requirements for the Arctic. Essentially, it is, as Bill mentioned, it is requiring that any operator in the Arctic bring with it, to the extent possible, all the infrastructure they think that the U.S. regulators think will be necessary to deal with the spill. It was actually Shell's inability to get certification for its containment vessel, the Arctic Challenger, I believe was the name of it, in 2012, that forced them to stop drilling in the Arctic in 2012, and they were not allowed to go into the hydrocarbon zone because they did not have on-scene capability to deal with an oil spill. And those are the requirements that are now being codified by the Department of the Interior. So that's a huge step forward to acknowledge the special challenges of the region and to have the vessels on scene. There still are enormous challenges. The Coast Guard is also on the scene. They have very limited capability up there. The United States has very few icebreakers. We are really not investing in the Arctic to deal with the special conditions up there, with oil and gas being the leading edge, arguably, but perhaps not, actually, probably commercial shipping now with the opening of the Northwest Passage in particular and the northern route through Russia. You're going to see more and more traffic up there with very limited capability to deal with a marine spill of any kind.
Willie, did you want to? Willie wanted to say something.
Subject. Go ahead.
You know, for me as a hunter, you'll never convince me that you're going to clean it up to our satisfaction. One of the things that is hindering all of this is that our permitting system doesn't allow anybody to spill some oil up there and clean it up, especially in ice conditions. First of all, you got to really understand the currents. You got to understand the climate. All of this so that you're proactive in cleaning it up. First of all, you got to make sure it doesn't happen, you know. But if it does happen, we're the ones that are going to suffer, not the oil company, not the government. We're the ones that are going to, the people.
So we have a question that came in on Twitter that I think is kind of interesting by Robert Hammett. Is there space, and maybe this is for you, Bill, a little bit, is there space for international cooperation in offshore Alaska drilling? After all, it's to everyone's benefit, all the countries' benefits, to minimize the risks of spills and have the public give Arctic development the social license to operate. So there is some gains if countries can cooperate with one another. So do you guys seek that kind of cooperation?
We do, and I think actually David should talk about this some too, since he was so involved. But obviously there's potential advantage, and for example, there is a somewhat embryonic international group called the International Petroleum Regulators Forum that we work with. We're very actively cooperating on research in the Arctic. Some of the staff of BOEM, you know, are frequently engaged in that. It is, and there is a draft sort of formal potential agreement with the Arctic Council that would help facilitate the sort of movement and open the data in respect to Arctic activities that's in the works. It's all a little bit complicated right now because of the difficulties that some nations are having with Russia, but we're kind of working through that.
In the report, we talk about joint industry research groups that include operators from other Arctic countries for the same reason, to try to collaboratively do research on this space. I might just conclude, there is a chapter on infrastructure. It's recognized as a major issue and that there ought to be collaboration involving the transportation community, the oil and gas industry, and all the rest to try to come up with good solutions.
So, okay, last question here, and then we're out of time.
Hi. Hello. I have a question for Jan Maris. My name is Sonia. I work for an organization called Our Task. We inform and empower young people to think globally. We do that because a lot of young people are really concerned and frightened about their future, the future of the Earth, and what we do through our life support systems. So my question is, the MPC Arctic Research Study, did they consider young people's perspective on this matter? Was there a youth statement in that research, especially, and even the unborn generations, if you think about, you know, if a child was born today, we hope it will still live in the 21st century. So do you take that into consideration when you conduct a research study like this?
Well, we weren't specifically asked by Secretary Moniz to try to think about that particular question. We were asked to think about what is the research and development that would be desirable to allow prudent development of the Arctic oil and gas resources, and that's what we strive to do. And we had a wide variety of ages on this group, so I'm sure that several were certain that they got into the mix of suggestions, ideas that would be responsive to your question.
Okay, so thank you very much. I want to thank you for our panelists, and thank you all for coming.